So you want to tell me?
What did you have in mind? Well,
let's see. I don't have anything in mind. My mind is an empty set right now. Let's see. Any songs about fear, trust? Let's see. Let's see. Let's see. Too high. Looking at songs. No, for me. That's true. Yeah, that's a good point. True. There's got to be something that. It's time already, and I'm still. Just throw out any song you're comfortable with, and I'll find it. What song's that?
You say don't trust in it? Something yeah. About either that or that should be.
What's that? What do you know what that was she just played? What is it? Does that sound right, Jane? Come every soul. Okay. Oh, that's good. All right. Could that be the song? Oh, okay. Good. Okay. Then I think we just got ourselves a song. 5:41. Let me see. And we're just going to do the one song, Jane. Would you be able to, after she's done playing, come and walk her back? Thank you. All right.
I'll be a dog.
Well, only trust him. Come, a dog. What's that mean?
You're gonna walk.
Oh, Gina didn't mean that. That's so disrespectful. All right. Good evening, everyone. We have a crowd tonight, real crowd. Good to have you all here tonight. Good to have you online. Let's all stand. We're only going to do one song tonight. Jane has agreed to just jump in, and we're going to turn to him. 5:41. Let's all stand, and we are going to open in prayer. This evening. Happy Valentine's Day. Hope you had a good day. Thank you. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the privilege of gathering together tonight in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, that we can stream tonight's service so that others can be with us and participate, join us, and receive from your word and glorify you. Father, bless those that are online. Bless those that are here. And I pray that tonight you would receive from us worship that would be acceptable in your eyes. Draw us close to you. Knit our hearts together. And we pray that our precious Savior, Jesus Christ, would be exalted. And we ask this in his name. Amen. All right, hymn 5:41, Only Trust Him, 3 verses, we'll sing all 3. Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord. He will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now. For Jesus shed his precious blood, rich blessings to bestow. Now into the crimson flood that washes white as snow. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now. On verse 3. Yes, Jesus is the truth, the way that leads you into rest. Believe in him without delay, and you are fully blessed. Only trust him, only trust him, only trust him now. He will save you, he will save you, he will save you now. Amen. And you may be seated. And I want to remind those of you that are here that have attended tonight, if you would like to give your offering on the way out tonight, you can do it on the plate there, or even come up here after the service and give. But we're going to move right into our message. And I'm so glad that you came tonight. Good to have you all here. I've really been excited about getting back into this series on fear. As you know, we're preaching in our evening services on a series going through 2 Kings chapter 6 and 7, and we are looking at fear. And that is something that is on everyone's mind in right now, and what's going on in our nation with the coronavirus. People are scared. People are really scared. And because of that, measures have been taken to try to protect Americans, and it has caused even more anguish, more sadness, not just in America, but all around the world. People are just, especially the elderly and those in nursing homes, have become isolated, and suicide has increased incredibly. It is just a sad, sad picture. And so I've wanted us to just kind of step back for a minute, if we can, look at the scriptures, and consider God in this setting. I'm reminded of Psalm 73, where Asaph really struggled with believing that God was good, because he was only looking around. You know, if you follow, I love Psalm 73. I'll probably preach it again soon. I've preached it before. But if you look through that psalm, Asaph says, "As for me, my steps had well nigh slipped." He was almost gone. He just almost gave up on life. And it was because he was looking all around him. He was seeing good people that were trying to do right, and it didn't seem to pay. It seemed like they were the ones that were having the troubles, the struggles. And then he looked at other people that were just outright violent and with no regard for others, and they seemed to be prospering. And he really struggled with grasping and believing that God was good. And if you go through that psalm, it's only at verse 17 where he says, "until." So from basically verse 2, because in verse 1 he begins by sharing his conclusion and what he had learned. But then in verse 2, all the way to verse 14, he just laments. And he basically has a glorified pity party. You ever been there? You know, just having a pity party. And it's easy when you're looking around you. You see what's going on. And then in verse 14, it says, "Until I went into the sanctuary of God." And when you read that, he's saying that he was looking at things without God in the picture. And it was only when he put God in the picture, you know, he went in the sanctuary of God, it reminded him, he's like, wait a minute, there is a God in heaven. And he said, then understood I their end. And then he understood the bigger picture, which is so easy for us to lose sight of in what we're going through. It is so easy to get caught up. You watch the news, you talk to people, there is just this mentality that can carry you away in fear, paranoia, desperation, and that describes our country, and it feeds off of everything. So what we're doing is we're going into the scriptures, we're just looking at two chapters in the Bible, and the experience primarily of God's prophet Elisha in a certain span in his life, and the nation of Israel, and we are seeing, it's just one example after another of things that were related to Elisha, some that were fear-related, from something very minor to something as catastrophic as a famine and desperation where people were literally dying, and we see, we're able to get perspective. So that's my goal. And tonight we're going to look at chapter 6, 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 24, into chapter 2. Actually, tonight I think we're going to move right into chapter 2. So as you know, there's been a siege in Samaria. It's the city of Samaria. It's where the Israelites are, and the Syria has come with their army and just blockaded everything. These huge, massive troops are lined up circling the city, blocking off all access, so no food, nothing can get in, nothing can get out, and they're basically just waiting it out. And they have, you know, all the army, thousands of army situated all around the city are just, they have all the food that they could want. And just a few hundred yards away, people are starving to death and eating their own children. It is just a horrible situation. And so we are going to look at tonight, 2 Kings chapter 7, and beginning in verse 3. Tonight's message is titled Fear's Focus. We're going to look at three things tonight as we work through this text. Two of the things are what fear does. First of all, fear magnifies the sufferings of this present time. So, and that's what was happening. And when you and I are going through a time of testing, when you and I are going through a difficult time, when we are experiencing hard times, it's hard to see anything else. And fear will cause us to magnify that experience. You think of all the precious people that have taken their lives in this past year because of the pandemic. People, and we don't often see all the statistics, folks, but regularly people are taking their lives. And there has been an upsurge in suicides because people are just, they're filled with despair. Remember what despair is. Literally, it's a Latin phrase, which means no hope. And that's what's happening. And when you're in the midst of suffering, fear magnifies that suffering. It's hard when you're going through a crisis to think that there's ever going to be an end to it. And you think that, you know what, this is my lot in life. This is the way it's going to be. So fear does that. Second, fear counsels us to give up. Fear has no reason, gives us no reason to press on. Just fear tells us, just give up. And that, we see this here. And then finally, here's the great thing. The fear of God, that's the opposite. In fact, it does just the opposite. Instead of magnifying the situation, fear gives us light at the end of the tunnel. Instead of motivating us to give up, fear gives us strong confidence to press on. So we're going to talk about the fear that so many experience today, and then we're going to talk about kind of fear that we need. We need to do what Asaph did. We need to put God in the picture. But it doesn't come natural. So let's pray. I want you, by the way, to be praying for Sada. I'm trying to remember what our prayer times, prayer things were from Wednesday. And I know that Sada has COVID and is really struggling. She was very, very sick. We still want to pray for little Braden. Dave Osenbach had COVID. He's now just finishing up that quarantine aspect. And I know the Saninos and the Ninos and some others in our church, some folks at Multicultural have COVID that are recovering from that. I think there's probably some more too. Let's bow in prayer. Father, thank you again that we get the privilege of worshiping you. And Father, it's exciting. We love studying your word. We love learning about how you related to people. And there's so much application in our lives, so many things that we need to learn about you. We go through life, Father, and we so quickly lose perspective. And we want to walk by faith 24/7. But Father, we confess to you that we too often fall into walking by sight, walking by experience, walking by feelings, walking by our environment and what's going on around us. And Father, I pray that you'd help us tonight to rise above that. Help us tonight to put you in the picture. Help us to see in this desperate situation that, humanly speaking, there'd be nothing good to come out of it. And in those situations, Father, you always work things together for good to them that love you. You have a purpose. And when you allow suffering for a time, it is always with a very specific purpose. And we're grateful, Father, that your desire is to bless and provide and be our strength. So lead us now, we pray, in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So 2 Kings chapter 7, fear magnifies the sufferings of this present time. That is a reference to scripture that we'll look at in a few minutes. But I want you to look at 2 Kings chapter 7. Okay, so we saw that they're in the middle of this siege, and the king of Israel comes to Elisha, and Elisha makes the prediction that tomorrow at this time, food is going to be in abundance. And it must have sounded like perhaps even the king may have interpreted his prophecy as mocking him. Because imagine, you know, when you're in a situation humanly and you cannot figure out how could that possibly be true, it could be easy for the king to think that he was taunting him. And that's happened in the scriptures. But we pick up, and so in fact, let's look at verse 1, 2 Kings chapter 7, verse 1. Then Elisha said, "Hear ye the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow about this time shall a measure of fine flour be sold for a shekel, two measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria. Then the Lord, on whose hand the king leaned, answered the man of God and said, Behold, if the Lord would make windows of heaven, might this thing be?" And this was being said from a perspective of unbelief. You know how we said the idea from your mouth to God's ears, you know, please, oh, I wish it was true. But how is that going to happen? You know, I wish that you were telling the truth. And then we say, see at the end of verse 2. And he said, that's Elisha said, "Behold, thou shalt see it with thine eyes, but thou shalt not eat thereof." And then we begin, verse 3. We begin with learning, peeling back the curtain so we can kind of see what's going on and how God delivers it, how it all comes out. Because by verse 3, something had happened. And we're going to read about it in a few verses. But what happens now with these four lepers is significant, because it doesn't change anything. I want you to keep this in mind. What we read about doesn't change anything, because what happened had already taken place. But if it were not for these four lepers, the people that were under siege in Samaria would have no idea that God had already delivered them. Pretty awesome. So let's look at it. Verse 3, "And there were four leprous men at the entering in of the gate." Now, there's a Jewish tradition, and there's really no evidence that this is true. But who knows? You know, it's one of those things that pass down time to time. And there's a Jewish tradition that the four men were Gehazi and his three children, his three sons. Remember, Gehazi was Elisha's servant that, you know, ended up getting the leprosy of Naaman. But you know, we need to keep that in the realm of tradition. And tradition, remember what tradition is. If it's not based on the Word of God, it's a nice story, you know. Could be true, maybe not. Sometimes it's not. If it goes against Scripture, it's not. Remember, we always have to judge everything through the colander of God's Word. So, there were four leprous men at the entering in of the gate. So, okay, we got this famine, which is in full swing. And as far as they know, as far as the king knows, as far as the king's servant knows that came to give the message to Elijah, as far as anyone in Samaria knows, except for Elijah, as far as they know, they are in the midst of a serious, long-term famine. They are in the middle of it, for all they know. Now, we know, because of what Elisha said, now that they weren't in the middle of it. They were at the end of it. Because remember what Elisha said? Tomorrow at this time. That's the light at the end of the tunnel. Now, Elisha said it, and the king didn't believe it. The king's servant didn't believe it. But he was giving them light at the end of the tunnel, and he's saying, this is going to end tomorrow at this time. And here's how it happened. So you got these four lepers, and they are at the entering into the gate. Now imagine what's going on now. Remember, lepers are unclean people. They cannot be near the general population. And so what happens is, when they, wherever they are, they have to shout out unclean and they have to keep a certain distance. Boy, we know all about that. Sounds like the quarantine, doesn't it? Unclean, you know, you're not allowed to get away from me. And that's the way it was. So they could not enter the city. Couldn't go in because they were lepers. And then, so they're, talk about a rock and a hard place. You're between a famine and an army, you know, a military army that could kill you. And that was how they had their existence. They were experiencing the same results of the famine. And they were, you know, they were here for probably months was the famine. By the way, let me share with you, it's interesting. I did a little study on famines. And in fact, I asked my son to Siri, you know, ask Siri, what was the longest siege ever, you know? And if my son's watching this, he's going to kill me. But I won't tell you which son, so there we're good. There's a certain anonymity. And he said, well, it was the siege of Canada. But I never knew that Canada was under siege. How about that? And he told me all these statistics, and it's like, wow. And I almost came to church that Sunday and preached that. You know the greatest siege was in Canada? And then I decided to check up the facts. And it actually was the siege of Candia, which happened in 1648 to 1669. So I'm so glad I cleared that up. Or I would have you all going, did you know the longest siege was in Canada? And you know how long the siege was? 22 years. Now the reason I had to look it up is because when my son gave me that fact, I thought, how can a siege last 22 years? I mean, people die. If you're not getting food and water, I mean, you drop dead. You don't last 22 years. It's a very interesting story. And of course, there were certain circumstances that enabled it to drag on so long. But that was the longest siege, the siege of Candia. The second longest siege was the siege of Philadelphia. Not this Philadelphia. So keep that in mind. It was a Greek city. It actually goes back to the city that we have the reference in Revelation, but there are several different cities of Philadelphia. This one happened in 1378 to 1390. It was 12 years. It's the second longest siege in history. The third longest siege was the siege of Ishiyama Hongenji in 1570 to 1580. That was 10 year long. The siege of Thessalonica in 1422 to 1430, that was an eight-year siege. And then the siege of Drepana was in 249 to 241 BC. That was took place during the First Punic War. I mean, these were sieges that lasted years. Probably the most famous siege that we know is the Alamo, you know, the, down in San Antonio, Texas, and that only lasted 2 weeks. Probably the most famous. Of course, there was the siege of Jerusalem in 7 AD, which lasted 7 months. But so we don't know exactly how long this siege was, but it was probably several months. We do know that it was desperate. Things got so bad. You remember the story about the two mothers that agreed to eat the one son? How horrible can times be where a mother would say, you know what, we're going to boil your son and eat him today, and then tomorrow we'll boil your son, and the other mother agreed to it. Mothers don't do that naturally. That was pure desperation. But I want to remind you that they are, as far as everything they know, they're in the midst. They're in the middle of a siege. And every day you are experiencing suffering, the despair level can increase. You remember the story that I shared with you about the Italian man named Dettore? I think I shared it recently. His wife had had a stroke and was in a coma for months. And he went and visited her. And God bless him, those first few weeks, he was probably like, okay, come on, Rosanna, please wake up, please wake up. And as every week and every day unfolded, he just lost hope. And what a tragic story that, like, was it 12 or 14 hours before his wife would wake up, he ran out of hope. And when you're in the midst of a trial, the sufferings of this present time can be so magnified in our mind that we lose all hope that there's an end. And the greatest way to lose hope is to just think that this is going to go on forever. That's where these people were. They were, as far as they knew, they were in the middle. But I want to remind you, not just Elijah's prophecy, you know, that should have been enough for everyone in that room and the king and his servant to have hope, because this was a man of God. This was Elisha. He had already established his integrity and his qualifications as a prophet of God. He was the real thing. And when he said tomorrow at this time, food is going to be in abundance, they had every reason to be encouraged. Christian, you and I have every reason to be encouraged. I want to read with you some scriptures. Psalm 30 and verse 5 says this: weeping may endure for a night, but do you remember what comes after that? Joy cometh in the morning. Now, this could be figurative. This is not a promise from God that all trials will be 24 hours or less. I wish. The Hebrew doesn't bring that out. The English doesn't bring that out. Nothing brings that out, because that's not what he's saying. But he is telling us, weeping may endure for a night. We're going to have times, folks, where we're going to have seasons in our life where they are sad times. But you and I have to understand, we have to believe that there's going to be joy down the road. We have this phrase that we, I don't know when it came started, but we talk about light at the end of the tunnel. There has to be an end. In fact, David himself said this. He said in Psalm 27:13, I had fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. You realize what he's saying? He said, you know what? I had fainted. I would have given up unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. He was counting on it. He knew that God was good. And he knew that God dispenses, he wants good. He knew the truth even before Jesus said, if a son asks for an egg, is his father going to give him, I don't know, what did he say, a scorpion, a stone? I forget what you know. If a son asks for something good, his father's not going to give him something bad. And David believed that truth. And so he would have fainted if he didn't believe, you know what, our God is good. For a time, for his higher purposes, and we don't always understand those purposes, but he had such a steadfast, committed belief that God was good, and he was going to see that goodness, that if he didn't, he would have fainted. He would have given up. And I think you and I, we do the same thing, don't we? You know, the awesome thing is, I want to remind you, we know the end. We know the end. Seriously. That, you know how important that is? We really, you say, oh, no, wait a minute. No, we really do know the end. We know the outcome. You see, us, those of us, if you are a Bible believer, if you've studied the Bible for any time, you know how this is going to end. And if you are a Bible-believing Christian, you know you're on the winning side. Even if you were to be martyred for your faith, and thousands have, you still know. It all turns out good. We know the end. You know, it's funny how, and that therein lies everything. Is the Bible true? Is it God's word? Can it be trusted? And if so, then we know the end. We can rest assured. Even if God were to take a loved one from us, we know, as what happened to the Thessalonians. God knew that, you know, when he took some of their people and they were despaired, like, what happened? This one, I knew God was going to come soon. I wasn't counting on this. And Paul wrote to them and said, concerning them which are asleep, you don't need to sorrow as others which have no hope. And then he shared with them a little bit about what's going to happen in the end. You know what? It's really going to happen. It really is. You know, when we bury someone, we put someone in a casket. You know, we who believe in Jesus, we know. We know what's going to happen. We really do. It's amazing how, and I know, knowing the nature of Satan, he wants to discredit the scriptures because therein lies our confidence in God's promise. Those are God's promises. I mean, that's what we quote all the time. When we're going through the valley, when we're going through deep times, we're quoting the promises of God. Like David, I had fainted unless I believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Like Paul, he said, the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us later, hereafter. Those are promises. So Satan doesn't want us to believe the scriptures. So he has launched an all-out assault on the Bible. And it's amazing how many people have bought the bait over the years. Do you realize over the years and over the centuries there have been things that if people did not find outside evidence of the scriptures about something in the Bible, they would doubt the Bible. You know, too many not believers, Bible believers didn't do that. And there have been numerous things over the years where there was no evidence, there was nothing. In other words, archaeology had never uncovered anything. For example, you ever heard of the city Ziklag? It's in scripture, it has to do with David. In fact, it's a very interesting story where the people of Ziklag were defeated, and while the military was out, and all the family, the wives, their stuff was plundered, and then David's men and his came back. It's an awesome story. Do you know that there is nothing outside of, there has been nothing outside the Bible about the ancient city of Ziklag other than what's in the Bible? So you know how many people who are buying the lie of the devil and they're like, it's fairy tale stuff. Now, you know, you believe in the Garden of Eden, you believe in Noah's Ark, and you believe, look at this example, Ziklag, it's a city, the Bible talks about it. Show me proof. They didn't have any proof until 2019, June. Archaeologists, and this happens all the time. Archaeologists uncover something. Oh, look at this ancient form here. And what's this city? Ziklag. Oh. Once again. And this happens all the time. There have been so many examples. Things like this, Dead Sea Scrolls, the Rosetta Stone, the Tel Dan inscription, which was a stone with writing on it. I mean, it's just year after year after year. Up until recent years, they're just constantly uncovering stuff that refute. Now, think about it. I wonder if there were people, I wonder how many people died prior to 2019 and they went to their grave and they were clinging to the fact that they could reject the Bible in their mind. And they use Ziklag, you know. And maybe they even showed their Christian friends. You believe the Bible? There's so many stories in there. There's no proof. Ziklag. Yeah, the Bible mentions Ziklag. There's no evidence of Ziklag. Ziklag never existed. I wonder how many people went to their grave believing that because there was never any evidence. And they died prior to 2019. Too bad. No, actually, they had the Bible. If they'd only believed the Bible, they would have had enough evidence. But you see, there is a demonic attack against the validity of the scriptures. And we need to realize that. And not just with facts and things like that. especially the promises of God. Satan is going to do everything he can. I want to remind you that in the book of Revelation, four different times, twice in chapter 1, once in chapter 21, and once in chapter 22, we find the Lord saying this, I am the Alpha and the Omega. And in some instances, he says the beginning and the end. In others, he says the first and the last. Why does he tell us that? Especially in the last concluding book of the Bible. He's letting us know. He, remember the Alpha and Omega, first and last letter in the Greek alphabet? He is saying, I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He knows what's going to happen in the end. And he's literally given us that information in the Bible. And how awesome. We really do know how it's going to end. What an awesome thing. I counted up the other day. It's such a my kids will be like, there you go, Dad, always thinking about death. I counted up how many funerals I've done over the years. And it's a lot of funerals. Do you know how awesome it is to be able to stand in front of people that are grieving, in front of a casket, and know how it's going to end? You know how awesome that is? I feel like I got to jump on a lot of other preachers that don't believe the Bible. You know, how awesome is that? We know the end. You know, this church has been, in some ways, populating over the years with new members, new people coming in, but it's also been depopulating. You know, precious people. We can go back to whenever we started, and there's people we knew that they kept dropping off. They kept dying. People we love. But we didn't lose them. We're just going to be, there's going to be, literally, you've heard this, you've sung about this, but believe this. There's going to be, literally, a grand reunion. It's going to be a meeting in the air in the sweet old by and by. We are going to be reunited with loved ones. And we have to believe that. We have to understand it because we have the Bible to believe it. Tell us. So, remember, next time you are in the midst of a trial, you don't know that you're in the midst of it. You could be, just like that Italian man, you could be 14 hours. Do you think that man would have took his life if he knew his sweetheart was going to wake up within the next 14 hours? Absolutely not. That hope, that light at the end of the tunnel, which grew dimmer and dimmer and dimmer, in his mind went out just hours too soon. And I submit to you, when you look at what happened here, this is awesome. So fear magnifies this present, the trials of the sufferings of this present time. Fear magnifies that. Secondly, fear counsels us to give up. Look at verse 4. 2 Kings 7, 4. If we say we will enter, this is now the four lepers, Gehazi and his sons. No, we don't know who it is. They're chatting, you know. And they say, you know, if we say we will enter into the city, the famine is in the city and we shall die there. Okay, that plan A, not going to work. If we sit here still, and that's what they've been doing, just sitting there, you know, just experiencing that in between a rock and a hard place, having no place to go. And that's what they were doing. And he said, so we die also. That's plan B. Both of them are dead end situations. Now, therefore, come, let us fall into the host of the Syrians. If they save us alive, we shall live. And if they kill us, we shall die. Okay, so all three possibilities include that there could be death. Only one of them was an opportunity that maybe they wouldn't die. And that's what they decided. So they decided to do that. And they rose up in the twilight, verse 5, to go into the camp of the Syrians. And when they were come to the uttermost part of the camp. Now the way this is written in the Hebrew, when it says the uttermost part of the camp, it's not just that they went to one of the outside perimeters, but the idea is they went to the farthest side. So they literally went, so you've got this siege around the city, and you got here's the city, here's these lepers, and you've got, you know, all the Syrian army. They literally circled around and went to like the back part of the Syrian army. That would have been the part that was least fortified. That, you know, that was the part, the back of the camp, as it were, and they entered in that way. And behold, there was no man there. Now, mind you, everything was present. The tents, none of the tents moved. None of the supplies moved. None of the clothing, I don't know if they have sleeping bags back then. I didn't study that out. I don't know if they had pillows, but I mean, just all the stuff for the camp was there. There was only one thing missing. The soldiers, they were gone. What happened? Well, I love this. This is so awesome. So let's read on here. 2 Kings 7. Behold, there was no man there. Verse 6, 4. Here's what happened. Now, this had already happened before anybody knew it. For the Lord made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots and a noise of horses, even the noise of a great host. And they said one to another, lo, the king of Israel hath hired against us the king of the Hittites and the king of the Egyptians to come upon us. Wherefore they arose and fled in the twilight, left their tents and their horses, their donkeys, their asses, and even the camp as it was, just as it was, and fled for their lives. They fled for their life. And when these lepers came to the uttermost part of the camp, they went into one tent, and they did eat and drink, and carried thence silver and gold and raiment and blankets and sleeping bags. No, it doesn't say that. But they just started plundering it. This is, can you imagine having experienced a famine where people are literally eating their children? You're a leper on top of it, so you can't even be commiserating with the people, you're the people of Samaria or in Samaria. It's just been the four of you. Here you are as lepers. You're also experiencing the famine. There's no food for you. You are nigh unto death. And when all hope is, they just think, you know what? We are going to die anyway. Why not try and just go to the Syrians and see if they'll have mercy on us? If they had never ventured out, if they had never took that chance, nothing would have changed. And everybody in Samaria would have died. And there would have been no army on the outside. Now, by the way, remember what happened? Who did this? I love it. It says in verse 6, the Lord made the host of the Syrians to hear a noise of chariots. It's interesting to read the commentaries about this. You know, they're like, okay, so what happened? Did God actually, like, you know how they say when a tree falls in the jungle or in the forest and nobody's there, does it make a sound, you know? So the people have actually debated, okay, did God make the sound happen audibly? So like if we could bring a video a cassette or audio recorder there, if we could bring our iPhones and record it, we would hear it. Or did God just put the sound in the ears of the Syrians? Who cares? Who cares? The bottom line is, it accomplished what it was. Those soldiers, every one of them, legitimately heard the sound. Again, what does it say? The Lord made the host of the hearing to Syria to hear the noise of chariots and the noise of horses, even the noise of a great host. So they, you know, they literally, folks, they're all hearing like two guys in a tent. Hey, Joe. Hey, Joseph. Did you hear that? Man, it sounds like some horses. Whoa, yeah. Sounds like soldiers. Man, there's an army out there. Oh, there's chariots. I hear it. And, it, you know, so it was confirmed. They all heard it. Enough that, folks, they didn't even say, oh, okay, you know, you better get packed. Hey, grab the gold. Hey, don't forget your mom's shirt there. You know, they didn't do that. They just left. They were so scared because it was so real to these hardened soldiers that they fled for their lives and left everything. And that was God's plan, wasn't it? God did that. That's what God's plan was. In fact, God even told Elisha ahead of time, here's what I'm going to do. Here's what I want you to say, because in 24 hours, guess what? There's going to be so much food. That there's going to be like a stampede. I mean, it's going to be so much food, you're not going to know what to do with it. And Elisha, he's like, well, God, you know, I need a little proof of that. No, Elisha didn't do that. He knew. He knew God's integrity. If God said it, he didn't need to see proof. You know, there's no evidence. And, you know, he wasn't like, well, God, would you replicate the sound that you're going to make that's going to cause the Syrian army. I'd like to see, I want to really make sure. No, Elisha didn't walk by sight. He walked by faith. And sure enough, that's exactly what happened. Now, what's so cool about this is that, and this is where we get to the fear of God. The siege, as soon as that happened, okay, we've got the sounds, and all this, every one of the soldiers heard it. It wasn't like half of them heard it, and the other ones are like, "What are you guys doing? There's no sound." They all heard it. So they, you know, imagine how quickly they conferred with one another. There's panic in all their eyes. Talk about panic. By the way, here's the great thing. One commentator made this statement. The same God who struck one Syrian army so they could not see what was there now struck another Syrian army so that they heard things that were not there. That's our God, still in control. So he caused these things to happen. Folks, as soon as those Syrians ran for their lives, I would have loved to have seen that on video, wouldn't you? A whole army of thousands and thousands of men. You could see probably fear in their eyes, and they're just running for their lives. They left the chariot. I mean, they left everything there. And folks, at that moment, the siege was over. It was over. But guess what? Nobody knew it. They were still living the experience of a famine inside the walls. They were still lamenting, "Oh, how hard this is, and it's so horrible." But the siege was over. But they didn't know that. Charles Spurgeon said this, "Everybody who went to bed that night felt that he was still in that horrible den where grim death seemed actually present in the skeleton forms of the hunger-bitten." Man, what a word, or what words. "They were as free as the hearts of the wilderness had they known it, but their ignorance held them in vile imprisonment." Oh, I love that. And doesn't that describe us sometimes? We are ignorant. Because remember, folks, we already know the outcome. It's already been written. The victory's already taken place. You and I are victors. Thanks be to God, which causeth us to be victors. Remember 1 Corinthians 15? What a blessing. Over death. That whole chapter is the resurrection. We have victory over death. And yet, these poor people did not even realize that they were free. But for the providential working of God in four men, four lepers, who decided to take a chance and go and just fall at the feet in the mercy of a Syrian army that wouldn't even be there. They were just free. And by the way, just so we touch base on this story, we'll finish this up next week, Lord willing. But they're having a heyday. In fact, next week's message is going to be about their focus. Their focus, you know, tonight's fierce focus. They were, at first, it was all about themselves. These men were starving. They had just experienced a famine. And if you want to play on their emotions, they were lepers. They were outcasts. And so you can hear someone saying, "Can you blame them for just taking it all for themselves?" It was just a free-for-all. They just pigged out. They're like gluttons. It's like they're just grabbing everything and high. You know, it's for this insane few moments, maybe an hour, who knows. It was just all about themselves. And then all of a sudden, one of them smacked to and said, "Wait a minute. What we're doing is not right." And he said, "There's, you know, thinking of the people of Samaria that were in the siege." And they said, "You know what? We've got to share. There's so much here that we've got to share." And there's a whole lesson in that. Again, we'll look at that next week. But I want to remind you that when they were in the midst of this trial, this serious famine, I want to remind you what Satan was whispering in their ears, because Satan has not stopped. Satan is a roaring lion walking about seeking whom he may devour. He's always done that. We can go all the way back to the book of Job. Some believe Job was a contemporary of Abraham. And Satan's still doing the same thing. Remember what Satan was doing? Job chapter 1, Job chapter 2. Satan enters into the presence of the Lord. And as soon as he starts his focus on where his attack is going to be, the accuser of the brethren says, God, if you allow trials in Job's life, he will. And he said this twice. He, you know how he showed his cards. He showed his motives. He said, he will curse you to his face. That's his goal. Don't ever forget that. That has not changed. That was not just on Satan's schedule and itinerary for one day many years ago. That's on his itinerary every day. He wants us to curse God. And whatever he can do in your circumstances, you better be sure he's whispering in your ear, curse God. Curse God to your face. Now that's an interesting phrase. Because Job, while he was on the earth, no man hath seen God at any time. What does he mean, curse God to your face? Satan says, you know, God, if you allow trials, Job's going to curse you to your face. I remind you, though Job could not see God, every utterance that Job would make was to God's face. Every utterance we make is to God's face. I know people, Christians, that have been so in despair that they allowed Satan to get them to do that, and they curse God. Many Christians have. By the way, if you've ever done that, if you've ever cursed God to his face, do not despair. That is not the unforgivable sin. Thankfully, folks, when Jesus Christ died on Calvary, he paid for everything. Hey, think about it. If God were harsh and severe, and if Job had like listened to Satan and cursed God to his face, and God was like, all right, that's it, Job, pss, you're dead, you know. If he had done that, if that was the way God was, but we know he wasn't that way. You know how we know? Because somebody did listen to Satan, you know, the whispering, curse God, curse God. Somebody listened to that, and it was Job's wife, right? Remember what Job's wife said? Job, why don't you just curse God? Where did that come from? I think we know. Where does it ever come from? It comes from Satan. He's the one that's whispering in our ears all the time. Curse God. Remember what happened after that? Remember what happened after Job's wife told Job to curse God? Remember she was leaving the city? She turned into a pillar of salt? Oh, wait a minute. That wasn't Job's wife, was it? I know. I knew that. The point is, Job's wife, folks, the rest of the book of Job is a story of blessing. God ended up blessing Job and the same wife with multitudes of kids and restored everything. And so Job's wife, even though she allowed Satan to get into her mind and curse God, what's the Bible say? There is forgiveness with thee that thou mayest be feared. God is so good. And you know what? No matter how many times we fail him, he is so merciful and so forgiving. And he wants us to just praise him. And you better believe, I would love to hear the story of Job's wife after, you know, towards the end. She probably could tell a great story. And she would tell a story of how she got so low. And she probably would say this with great shame, maybe with tears. I can't believe I encouraged my husband to curse God. And God is so awesome. And that's how she would have ended with, because she lived the blessings. Why? Remember what David said? I would have fainted if I hadn't believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. So folks, you and I, that's where we go back to Paul's statement. The sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared to the glory which shall be revealed in us. So let's praise God. Let's not let the fear of the trial, the fear of the situation magnify and in our minds, and let's not let fear cause us to give up. Let's say God puts us all in a situation. Let's say God allows a worldwide pandemic. Oh, wait a minute, he did. We have a perfect opportunity to walk by faith and show a scared to death world that our God is in control and that you and I can have confidence. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for this situation of Elisha and Jehoram and these four lepers, whoever they were, and just this wonderful event. Father, I can't wait to get to heaven and get to talk to some of the people that were part of this and ask them all kinds of questions and learn things about this and get details that no doubt will just amaze us and bring more glory to you. And Father, it's exciting when we think about that. But Father, you're still doing things now. You're doing things like you did back then. You're doing them now in glorifying yourself. So help us to be the Elishas of the day. Help us to walk by faith. Help us to trust you no matter how bad things get. And Father, we ask your blessing. Help us to take these things with us for the rest of the week and really for the rest of our lives. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. We are done. There will be no singing, and we will end our service.